Spiritual Revival Hour. This is the founding program here on Least Access TV, now Channel 28, created by Dr. Benjamin Twin B. Brown. We represent words and songs of inspiration, consolation, meditation, and education. I am Victoria Carrion, 12 years old, the youngest co-host on our production team. And we're going to begin our presentation today with a special dedication to our senior citizens, sick, shut-ins, along with the less fortunate.
Right now. Welcome, welcome, welcome to the Spiritual Revival Hour. Y'all know who I am, and just in case you don't, I'm Edwina Bell, your host. And if it wasn't for Dr. Benjamin Twimby Brown, I and many others would not have been able to share information about consolation, education, meditation, and inspiration. And as a result of his 70 plus years in the community and really all around the world, we bring to you today a very, very, very interesting topic that is known as the Cancer Month of October. And so here with me today is a couple of young ladies who are from the Women Walking in Faith to talk about their upcoming event. And so I'd just like to again thank Benjamin Twimby Brown for allowing us to get the word out, letting the positive outshine the negative. And so joining me right now, we have the founder of the Women Walking in Faith. Your name?
My name is Valerie Edwards.
Mm-hmm. And Valerie, we've been talking on the phone. We are Facebook friends.
Yes, yes, we are.
Every time I see something positive in the community that can uplift and inspire those who may be in the trenches, those who are thinking about it, those who don't want to think about it, to make sure we illuminate the positive out of a negative situation.
Yes,
and
ma'am.
So your organization does just that. Tell us about your organization.
I started this, Women Walking in Faith. My dear cousin died from breast cancer, and it really took a toll on me to see, and she was young. So I started the group, got a name that I thought that was really positive of Women Walking in Faith, because that's truly what it is, Women Walking in Faith. I started like 10 years ago with another one of my girlfriends. We had it events in the church, and we took it out of the church and started doing things on the outside. I had honor women that was past and present that was surviving breast cancer. And my first one was 2000. It had to be like 12 or 11. Mm-hmm. Can't actually remember. But it was a blessing just to hear the women's testimony stories of where they've been at. So we do, you know, went out and scouted out women, you know, having women getting honored to tell their story that might help somebody along the way. Mm-hmm. And it has been a blessing. I think we got put down a little bit from the pandemic because I was supposed to have an event right when the pandemic happened. Everybody said, well, what happened? So, you know, God fearing it didn't stop. I was still working on it. And here we are now for our events coming up on the 29th. And I thank God that it was him just kept on letting me just have that mind determination to continue to help women and have women come and educate me on breast cancer. Mm-hmm. So
one of the things that you said that is important, oftentimes a lot of things are birthed in the church. And we know that the church is really within us, and
yes,
that we
ma'am.
Enter four walls. And so I just believe that coming beyond the four walls into the community, you can reach more people. So how did you decide to pick your venues throughout the years, and why this particular venue at the public library?
I met one of the girls that kind of did my hair, and we were talking about it. And she was telling me about the Women's Library, and they do a lot of events there. And it's really so public that, you know, you can get a lot of people to come out to support you in downtown Wilmington. And I was like, great. I'm looking for a hall. I already had a hall and everything like that. And the guy shot me down. So, well, you can't get your money back. And see, money's the root to all evil. So I didn't worry about that. I said, I'm going to go ahead. And when she said, she'll check with it. And why was it a blessing that the 29th was open, the date that I had picked? I said, that was nothing but God. And it's not like I pulled away from my church, because I still work in the church and do things in it. But I had to just pull away just to get a little bit out there. Mm-hmm. You know, we're structuring the church and everything, you know. So I just, it's not that I pulled away from the church. I just still affiliate myself with my church and whatever I can do to help to support them. But I needed to dig out into the community a little bit more.
Yes.
You know, to bring my whereabouts, you know, back.
During your 10 years of producing this program, how did you or do you recruit your participants?
I just like been going out into the community, like going to the stores, meeting people at different events they've had. Especially I went to a lot of breast cancer events and just meeting people and talking with them, hearing their stories and kind of like, okay, here we go right here. So I'd always jot things down. And I just met some wonderful people along the way. The one year I went somewhere, I met a lady that said that this one young lady touched her heart so much. And she's like, can you please just honor her this year? And it happened to be Shea. Aww. And Shea was our second year of honoring when we did eight women. We honored seven women because seven is completion. So we honored seven women and she was one of the seven women that we honored. Mm-hmm. So just going out fellowshipping.
One of the other things that I am, I guess, excited about is that when you honor people and people come, they bring sometimes pictures of their loved ones who have some type of cancer.
Yes.
And you have on the different tables a picture of those individuals. And so once you recruit that person and you have them speak, they basically share their story, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And so the event is October the 29th.
Yes.
3 to 6.
2 p.m. to 6 p.m.
Mm-hmm. And
at the Wilmington Library in downtown.
Does that include food? What is the cost?
Yes, the cost is $25. Mm-hmm. And that includes your meal also. And also it includes hearing the testimony stories of the women that have survived breast cancer, and we're doing it in memory of also.
Okay. Well, that brings me to our speaker of the event. And introduce yourself and just tell us a little bit about who you are and how you are a breast cancer survivor.
Okay. Well, my name is Shea Robinson. I am an 8-year breast cancer survivor. I was diagnosed May 19th of 2015. With my diagnosis, it was an aggressive form of diagnosis, DCIS in situ. I was considered stage 2B. I received two surgeries. I had to go back in for a reincision. I was given 12 rounds of chemotherapy, 8 weeks of radiation. During my second treatment of chemotherapy, my port became infected, and I found myself in the hospital for several days. And the journey continued. I became an advocate. I was already an advocate of doing other things, but I became more of an advocate around breast cancer because I realized that, you know, it's important to self-advocate for yourself. Having that experience of with my port being infected, if I didn't push to keep going back, I may not be here today, and I can tell more about that later.
Okay. Yes. One of the questions I do want to ask, the development of breast cancer is many and varied.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And so when people hear the word breast cancer, they generalize it, mm-hmm. when in all actuality, there is different forms of breast cancer. Mm-hmm. And were you able to identify not just what it was, but where it came from?
Wow. I can tell you where I believe it came from.
Okay.
So first, I had my mammogram in February. That's mm-hmm. number one. I did a self-examination in April. So that's another important thing. But where I believe it came from was a combination of stress. In my life at the time, I was, you know, raising my younger daughter, stepdaughter, diagnosed with severe mental illness. It was extreme. And I think just a combination of that, because there, I had no history of breast cancer on both sides. I talked to family on both sides. Now we, you know, have a history of having dense breasts. So I had gone through different challenges with my right breast before, but then I found that the cancer, I actually found it was a knot. And having that previous treatment before, I was told that cancer doesn't change its form. So when I found the knot, I knew what it was. I knew what it was, and I waited several days, and the form never changed. Wow. So then I made the phone call to the cancer center for my appointment. So,
okay. Yeah. So before we go to break,
yes,
I want to ask you in terms of the treatment. Many people don't access support systems while they're in treatment.
Yes.
Coming from a 12-step program of 33 years, I know the importance of being able to talk, share with others who are going through the same. And for those who are in the same boat, not that we don't care about the other people and their care and support, but when you're going through something, there's a type of language, there's a type of support that needs to be conveyed, because most people don't want to hear nothing.
That's right.
They just want to be held. They just want to lay your shoulder, their head on someone's shoulder, you know. And so by being in a 12-step support group, did you, and do you know of any other women who sought support during the process?
Absolutely. I definitely sought support. I knew the importance of that. Like you said, I did it when, you know, losing a spouse. I immediately got into a connection of people. And when I got diagnosed, I connected with everything I could through Christiana Care, some other services, DBCC. And it was important. And then it increased my passion to want to do more to help and educate others. So I even got educated on triple negative breast cancer, to go out and express, you know, things you can do, preventative measures,
to help
other women.
Well, thank you for that, because we're going to come back and we're going to get into some more information, but also some positive affirmations that people can be uplifted even while they're going through. So if you yet live, there's a chance. Stay tuned, and the Spiritual Revival Hour will be right back.
I've got so much to thank God for. So many wonderful blessings and so many open doors. Yeah.
Sherry Dorsey Walker, State Representative for the 3rd District, and I'm seeking your support to become Lieutenant Governor for the state of Delaware in 2024. 1 year from today, we shall be voting in the Democratic primary. I'm asking for your support to be your next Lieutenant Governor for the state of Delaware. On Juneteenth, we made a historical announcement at the Congo Legacy Center. I am Representative Sherry Dorsey Walker of the 3rd District, and I'm officially announcing my candidacy for Lieutenant Governor for the state of Delaware. As your next Lieutenant Governor, my platform will focus on agriculture, criminal justice reform, economic opportunities, voting rights, and access to affordable housing. It is my desire to assist on the disparities plaguing our communities throughout our state. The educational crisis, gun violence, health and insurance inequities. The Lieutenant Governor presides over the Senate and serves as the chair of the Board of Pardons. My recent work on the Board of Parole and within the criminal justice system prepared me for this role. Team Sherry Dorsey Walker is working diligently and tirelessly to ensure that we win on September 10th, 2024. However, we need your assistance. Help can come in the form of volunteering, making telephone calls, purchasing t-shirts on the website. We're looking to raise $200,000. I'm asking that you please go to SherryDorseyWalker.com and make your contribution. Remember, together we rise to unify. Vote Sherry Dorsey Walker for Lieutenant Governor, September 10th, 2024.
Sherry Dorsey Walker!
Attention everyone on Medicare. New Medicare Advantage plans are now available. Did you know that you may be eligible for additional Medicare-approved benefits that include free eyeglasses, free hearing aids, free meal delivery, free rides to medical appointments, and much more? The Medicare Benefits Hotline is now open. Just call the toll-free number on your screen now to see if you qualify for additional Medicare benefits and make sure you're getting all the benefits you deserve. Just call 800-520-3805 now. In addition to dental, vision, hearing, and prescription drug coverage, you may also qualify for $0 monthly premiums, $0 deductibles, and no copays. Just call the toll-free number on your screen now to see if you're eligible for additional Medicare benefits that may include free eyeglasses, free hearing aids, free meal delivery, free rides to medical appointments, and much more. The call and Medicare benefits review are absolutely free. There's no obligation to enroll. Just call 800-520-3805 to see if you qualify.
They come to make you strong. Floating on the sea of trouble. Sorrow falling like rain from the sky. Trotting through life's murky waters. Trials form the tears in your eyes. Don't. Telling you there's a blessing on the other side of
through. Over the years, we've met so many nice people and good customers. I call them my friends. Most of my furniture is contemporary. Good style, good quality. My son does all the buying. We have the lowest prices around. We try to cater to what the area wants. We have a wonderful delivery service, probably better than anybody in the city. We've been here 34 years. Just come in and say hi.
To the highest mountain that flows to the lowest valley. How many of you have had that blood applied to your life? And you know that same blood gives us strength from day to day, and it will never, never, everybody say never,
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 never
lose its power. Danny say that.
The blood that Jesus shed for me.
Yeah.
When
It was the blood that gave me strength from day to day. It will never, never, never lose. Oh no, lose its power. Oh.
Hi, my name is Dr. Sharon L. Burton. I am elated to write the legacy of Dr. Twin B. Brown. This leader introduced internet cable to Wilmington, Delaware and Newcastle County. He is a founding member of the Ministers Action Council, otherwise known as IMAC, and he conducted hands-on video workshops for youth as well as adults. Through writing this legendary leader's truth and legacy, I have the opportunity to shed light on Dr. Brown's life and accomplishments, including his impact on the community and the field in which he works. The text will shed an account of his life, professional achievements, including his contributions to the community. Overall, this book has the potential to be an incredible resource for those interested in Wilmington, Delaware's history and anyone seeking to learn from such a remarkable individual like Dr. Twin B. Brown.
I've done. Speak for me. Amen. May the word I've done speak for me.
Welcome back to the Spiritual Revival Hour, where we talk about inspiration, consolation, meditation, and more importantly, education. Thanks to Benjamin Twin B. Brown for 70 years of making the positive outshine the negative, yet here we go again. The month of October is focused on breast cancer, but many of you know cancer is cancer. But you need to know there are different types and forms of cancer. We would like to emphasize prevention, intervention, as well as restoration. So our guest today was Valerie Edwards, and our guest speaker for the October the 29th event from 2 to 6 at the Wilmington Library. Cost is $25, right? You get a meal, but more importantly, you get inspired. You get uplifted. Even if you're going through, we will help us get through together. So Shea, welcome back.
Yes.
And as I was telling, talking with Shea and Valerie, your experience of her going through support throughout a 10-year experience with this, how many of your participants talked about and encouraged getting support systems in place?
A lot of the women did. That was one of the things when we go and have the events we have in their testimony stories, and they share with women, you know, their support system. I mean, because it's very important to have a support system. So they really enlighten a lot, especially if you're not even walking that walk with breast cancer. So every last one of the women had a support system that might help somebody else that did not even know about
okay.
it. Even taking them to go get mammograms,
mm-hmm.
holding their hand to do that. Some are so scared, and it was crazy because I did that myself. I was so fear of going and getting a mammogram because I heard of the what it does to you and everything like that. And I had one of my survivors. Okay.
Pancake.
Yes. And woo! It was like, oh my God, it was my fear. And I had to get over that fear. And I had one of, she was my supervisor at the time. And I honored her that year. And she said, no, I'll hold your hand and take you. And it was just that support to go get that done. You know, us African-American women sometimes don't have signs and symptoms.
Exactly.
So it was a beautiful thing.
Now, we also know that in the process, there's a before, during, and after. Mm-hmm. Okay. And a lot of information can be given at events like this.
Mm-hmm.
But where do they go after the event? Who do they talk to? Who do they contact? Where are the support systems? What are resources that you will be distributing? So what happens after the event, Valerie?
And I think after the event, we keep on, and for me, I'm stepping off out on faith on this.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to keep on getting resource and everything where women can go at. Even with this Susan G. Komen, and I'm not knocking anything about it, but it doesn't put money back in the pocket to help these women struggling from breast cancer. And we might need a light bill paid, rent paid, food on the table. That does not do that. So getting some of these small committees out here, organization that can help women, they do events to help give them some money. Some women are scared to, you know, and they're going through breast cancer, But Susan Jill Komen can't help you. They're doing research. And I thank God for the research, but they need help also. Mm-hmm. You know?
I'm so glad you brought that up.
Yes.
Shay, you know, not to get into your business, but to get into your business.
That's fine.
When people go through stuff like this, everything kind of shuts down. Mm-hmm. And like you said, stress can be brought on even the more mm-hmm. because you're thinking about how you're going to pay the bills, how you get the kids there, how you going to do that. So talk to us briefly about your situation and how you were able to manage your time management and your financial resources. Did you need help? Did you get help? Did you even ask for help?
I did. I did need help. I found myself at that time, because I was quiet, I was taking a lot of, you know, things in, you know, with family. And I found myself one day sitting at my desk just crying. And I realized I needed help. So I needed some additional help too, you know, as far as therapy. So that was very important. But I had to seek help in different organizations to be around other women who knew like you say, you talk about the language, who was experiencing what I experienced. And you can talk to me all day long, but if you haven't gone through what I'm going through, you know, it's kind of hard to really receive it. I appreciate it. But listen, when I'm in the middle of the night, when I wake up with night sweats, when my bed is soaking wet because I'm sweating, when I wake up and I can't move my body, who can help me with that? So it was very important to be engaged with other women to hear their story. It wasn't just me. That was the thing. It wasn't just me. So being an advocate. So that was very, very, very important.
So did you get financial help?
I didn't get financial help. Okay. I didn't get financial help.
But you needed it? Did you need it?
I didn't need financial help.
Okay, okay. But some people
I had a great support family. I had a great support system. Okay. My family, my church family, work, you know, was very, very supportive. So in that area, I didn't need it, but she's right. We have an organization too that we're a part of with Sisters on a Mission. You know, we provide assistance when going out with helping other women, going to their appointments, supporting them, praying with them, whatever it may be. Because you don't realize, you know, the impact that it has on the mind.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
As a woman.
Mm-hmm. And I'm glad you mentioned that because my daughter is a survivor of breast cancer.
Yes.
And she was young when she was diagnosed with it. And so no matter what age you are, but it appears to be any age you're impacted by, it doesn't matter, it's the mental thing, right? But even with my daughter, because she was young, the vanity, the image, how it affected her self-esteem. Did you go through any of that and your friends?
Perfect question. Yes, absolutely. Yes. I sit here today. I never wore makeup, never wore lashes, never put any makeup on my face. Now today, because of what cancer did to my body, I have blotches on my skin, and I don't know if it's vanity. Maybe it is vanity, you know, because now I feel like I need to wear a foundation. I feel like I have to put eyelashes on. I don't care if I'm running late for something. I'm like, hold on, son, I can put my eyelashes on. I won't leave the house, but it really does. I don't feel like I didn't feel like I was beautiful. I didn't feel like I was beautiful. I didn't feel like I was attractive, and it really messed my head up a little bit. So yes, it did. It had a great impact. Yeah.
And some of the stories that you heard from your previous
attendees? I just can't wait. I mean, I'm talking to camera now for everybody to come out to see this event. Mm-hmm. The testimony stories you're going to hear, it's going to be so uplifting. So we're looking forward to people coming out to support. And it's not like $25. I'm saying a donation, just giving a donation, sponsoring the women. Just do anything. And I wanted to bring about too, Ms. Bell, that not only women, men.
Thank you.
Men are out there getting breast cancer and they're not thinking it's not just a woman thing. It never says it was designated for women. It's men or women. Mm-hmm. So all types of race. So we got to look at that too. Mm-hmm. So it's just not African American women. Mm-hmm. So we're hoping everybody can come out and support the women. 8 beautiful women. And the testimony stories, we're going to leave there with a blaze of fire coming up out of there just to see these women. Yes, we ready.
So when the event is over, is there a follow-up? Do you contact other people? So what is what happens afterwards?
After that is I make sure that all my survivors have all my contact information and we're still out there in case if something happened to them. They need some type of financial help or anything like that. Mm-hmm. We're going to keep on going through it. It's just not going to be, as you see, it's not going to be only October when the year that Shea got honored, we was in February. So it's not a certain month that we have to pick for breast cancer in October. We're going to celebrate women and men anytime. Mm-hmm. So we're going to keep on finding resources, doing training sessions. I'm trying to get a lot of that set up so we can be constantly out in the community. So that's why we're asking for sponsors or anybody that has a heart to know what a woman, a man is probably going through, surviving breast cancer, people that passed on. I mean, so we're going to keep on moving and keep on shaking with this, okay. You know.
Mm-hmm. Well, with the last few minutes that we do have, I understand the need for support, the desire for the support, but sometimes we have to do it for ourselves.
Yes.
And I know, Shay, you did something extraordinary to help affirm yourself and be positive to yourself and to encourage yourself. And tell us what you did, and we're going to close out with your song.
One of the things I did.
And talk to the camera.
One of the things I did, my daughter encouraged me. It was back in 2016 to do the Soul Going Challenge by Monica. So I came up with this. I wish I had the beat behind me, but I'm going to do my best.
That's right.
Okay. I got the bad news in year 2015. I looked my husband in the eye and began to cry. It was the worst news of the year. Oh my God, it almost had me in such fear. No one couldn't give me an answer. I was the only one diagnosed with breast cancer. I started thinking I'm an elder mom and a wife, and I thought about how much I really love my life. I took the word, I spoke faith into my own, and I stand here in victory because the cancer's gone.
Yes. That is beautiful.
Yes.
So we only have like 2 minutes left, right? So it's October the 29th, 2 to 6 at the public library. Are tickets on sale?
Yes.
Public library tickets on sale or online? You can pay at the door?
What? No, you can't pay at the door. It's $25. We have the flyers displayed on Facebook as a donation. You can send your money to $Woman102. It's a Cash App. Your name will be at the door under whatever survivor that you're coming. So we're asking all family and friends to come out and support all the women. We got 8 women that's ready to blaze.
Yes. And let me close out by saying I too am a cancer survivor. Mm-hmm. Y'all know I've been in recovery from drug addiction, alcoholism, and prostitution for 33 years. And I got cervical cancer from having STDs during my addiction. And so because of a God that I didn't know, but I found on February the 22nd of 1990, I am healed.
Come on.
But I just want you to know that there's many ways to get cancer. Mm-hmm. Like she said, stress. I think people put too much deodorant on. I think the food we eat. There are many causes. So let's talk more about prevention, so that we can educate our younger people and those who are in it, talk about intervention. And then for those who are in it and need to be restored, let's talk about restoration. She says something about vanity. Listen, because God saved my life 33 years ago, listen, you see these pearly white teeth? They not mine. You want me to take them out? No? Okay, I won't take them out. But I do take them out. So I ain't worried about how I look. I'm worried about the spirit that God gave me.
Yes.
And so no matter how I look, I serve God, and my job is to serve others. So on behalf of the Spiritual Revival TV Production Hour, I am Edwina Bell, and thank you, Benjamin Twimby Brown, for your 70-plus years and making a positive outshine the negative. See you next time.
He loves to hear the wind sing as it whistles through the pines on mountain peaks. And he loves to hear the raindrops as they splash to the ground in a magic melody. And he smiles in sweet approval as the waves crash to the rocks in their harmony. All creation joins in unity to sing to him majestic symphony. But his favorite song of all is the song of the redeemed. When lost sinners now they plead.
as they sing, holy, holy is the Lamb.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lamb.
Heaven's choirs in harmony lift up praises to the great I Am. Listen as a newborn soul sings, I have been redeemed. But his
favorite song of all is the song of the redeemed. When lost sinners now make me lift their voices loud and strong.
Yeah.